بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا الأمين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين، وعلى من تمسك بسنته المطهرة إلى يوم الدين. ثم أما بعد، فإن خير الكلام كلام الله، وخير الهدى هدى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. أعاذنا الله تعالى جميعا من عذاب نار جهنم. First, I want to apologize for the lateness. Someone committed suicide on the train that, or the track that we were using to come here. I left Birmingham in more than enough time to be here, but when the person committed suicide, they shut the track down and they diverted our train, so we wound up coming at least 30 minutes late. Nonetheless, you people remained in the masjid, and as long as a person prays and he's in the masjid and he continues on his wudu, his tahara, he's still in the salat, and the malaika of Allah Azza wa Jalla, they make istighfar for that individual while he's in that condition. So with that being the case, asa an takrahu shay'an wa huwa khayrun lakum. May Allah accept your sabr. Concerning the topic that the brothers asked me to deliver today, I think is really an important topic. It's an extremely important topic, and I would like to tackle it, inshallah ta'ala, straight ahead, as I do, and without mixing my words, but without being offensive at the same time. So with that being the case, we ask Allah Ta'ala for his tawfiq and for the ability to express our risala here today. When we talk about loving the Nabi of Al-Islam, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, we should realize that this topic is an expansive issue. And it's not one of those issues that the goal and the objective is just to come in to give some rhetoric and that's it. Because actions, they speak louder than words in our religion. Al-af'al ablagu min al-aqwal. Statements are important in al-Islam. I have to tell my wife that I love her. I have to tell my parents that I love them. I have to tell my children that I love them, because the kalam is important. The man came and he said, Ya Rasulullah, Qulli fi Islam, Qulli fi Islam shay'an, La as'aluhu ghayruka. Tell me something that I only can ask you of. I can't ask anyone else but you. He said, Qul, amantu billahi thumma istaqim. Say with your lisan, say, I believe in Allah, and then be upright. So he did tell him, you have to say it, but then you have to do the actions. Because you can say all you want, I love Allah, I love Islam, I love the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but if it's not reflective in your actions, then actions speak louder than words. My mother, my father, I just came from visiting them recently in November in America. If I truly love my mother and my father, then I have to be sure to do whatever I can possibly do to give them da'wah Allah so that they don't die on kufr and shirk. If I really love them, I have to be respectful to them. I have to honor them. I have to have al-birr towards them. If I don't do that, I'm acting crazy with them. I can scream all that I want, that I love them, I love them, I love them. But if my actions are not reflective upon that, then really my kalam, I'm just like those people who do hypocrisy and nifaq. يَقُولُونَ بِأَلْسِنَتِهِمْ مَا لَيْسَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ. The munafiqun, they say with their tongues that which is not really in their hearts. So that's why al-iman, faith, it is the statement with your tongue, I believe in Allah. And if you believe in that in your heart, and then after that, you have to show that on your limbs. You have to pray. You have to fast. You have to do what Allah commanded you to do and stay away from what he told you to stay away from. So there is this issue that the hypocrites used to claim during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that they loved Allah, and they used to say that they were munafiqun, and they're kuffar. Inna al-munafiqin fi ad-dark al-asfali min an-nar. The munafiqin will be in the lowest portion of the hellfire because of the danger that they pose on the ummah. We have to look at them as being Muslims, but in reality they're the enemies, and they're compromising so many things. So their reward is they will be in the lowest level of the hellfire. They get a serious punishment. But they were screaming, we love Allah, we love Allah, we love Allah. And then Allah revealed what the scholars of Islam called the Ayat al-Mihna, the ayat of a test. It's the ayat that tested them. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهِ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذَنُوبَكُمْ. Tell them, Muhammad, tell these people, if you people really love Allah as you claim, then follow me and follow my sunnah. And if you do that, Allah will forgive you. He will forgive you for your sins, and He'll have mercy upon you. So that goes to show it's not enough for a person just to say, I love the Nabi. And then when the time of the Maulid comes, he dances and he sings and things like that. But other aspects of the religion, basic aspects of the religion, he's not doing those things. He's not doing those things like at least praying 5 times every day and things like that. So this issue is a why, and it is an expansive issue. It's not like some small issue. We can deal with it from many angles. But the angle that I want to deal with it from is the realistic angle. This is my first time being in this masjid. And when I come to masjids, I really don't look at the design of the masjid or the paint. I don't really look at the walls and the lights. What I want to see is, do I smell the aroma of the sunnah in that masjid? Do I see from the people, these people are being educated, because look how they're behaving and look how they're sitting and look what they're doing. Someone comes to your house, he knows what level of religion is this individual is on. He gets an idea because he sees what's going on. And that's why that tremendous tabi'i, from the tabi'een, his name is Alqama, he said about the tabi'un concerning the companions, kunna idha atayna ar-rajul lina'khudha anhu al-'ilm nanzuru ila salatihi wa samtihi. The people of the past, they said, if we went to a place to take knowledge from a person, the man left Egypt and he went to Medina. He left Medina and he went to Khurasan. He left Khurasan and he went to Baghdad to get knowledge from the Imams of Al-Islam. He said, if we went to take knowledge from someone, we would not take knowledge from him until we first looked at how he prayed. And we would look at his samt. Did he drink with his right hand? Did he eat with his right hand? Did he give with his right hand? Did he take with his right hand? How was his outer appearance? And they weren't judging the person. They just were getting, an idea of what's his level of Islam. How is he Islamically? They wouldn't just come and sit with someone and take knowledge from him. If the guy is praying, when he was praying, did he have the discipline of a salat? Or when he was praying, he was looking all over the place? Because if he was like that in his prayer, then the prayer being the most important issue, he's going to be like that in everything else. He's not competent, qualified to take knowledge from. Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna asraka ar-rajul alladhi yasraku min salatihi la yaqimu ruku'aha wa la sajudaha. The biggest thief, it's not those guys in Enron, you know, those big companies, the presidents and CEOs of the bank, they're thieves. And after they get caught, they give them a severance pay and they go off into the sunset. They're thieves. But the Prophet said, the biggest thief is the one who steals from his prayer. He doesn't have like the proper rukur when he's bowing. He doesn't do the proper sajda. He's just moving real fast. So the people of the past, the point, if they were to take knowledge from someone, they would come and they would look at him first. Look at his outer appearance. Because in Al-Islam, the Muslim has to make a statement as soon as you see him. You have to acknowledge she's a Muslim right away. You recognize it. And that's why, you know, these words that we used to use when I was young, we can't use them anymore because they are politically incorrect. Politically incorrect. Like, for an example, you can't call a person a midget anymore or a dwarf because that's offensive. You have to say he's horizontally challenged. You can't call people handicapped anymore. That's politically incorrect. You have to say they have special needs because the one who is handicapped, he says, hey, don't call me handicapped. I could do whatever you do. I can go to the Olympics. I can do a marathon. I do things that you don't do. Don't call me handicapped. So you have to change a lot of the language. One of the things that I think we should change and be sensitive to is I don't think we should use that word melting pot, the melting pot of America, the melting pot of Europe, meaning so many cultures and people come together and we just melt in the same pot. I don't want to melt. I want my Islam to be distinct. I want to get along with everybody. I want to have community cohesion. I want to respect everybody and you respect me, no problem. But I don't want my kids to melt in no pot. I want my kids' identity to be clear and distinct. That's why one of the most important aspects of al-Islam is al-bara'atu min ash-shirk wal-mushrikeen. That we have to free ourselves from ash-shirk and mushrikeen. What does that mean? That we're nasty people, antisocial people? Doesn't mean that. It means that we are distinct in the way we are. Our aqidah, our ibadah. We are distinct in our ayad. We don't participate in those three things with them at all. So no, we don't believe in the melting pot. I think we should use the word like fruit cocktail or something like that. Everybody like this banana, that one is a pineapple, that one over there is a watermelon. You maintain who you are. And this is one of the challenges of living in the country that we live in right now, in Europe. That in 15, 20 years, if we don't do something about our situation and we don't get serious and stop doing this lip service, normative Islam is going to be changed. On the day of Al-Jumu'ah, you won't be surprised 15 years from now, the Islam of our kids. There will be a lady who makes the adhan and another lady who makes salat the khutbah of Al-Jumu'ah if we're not careful. And that's what the Prophet said. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, يَدْرُسُ الْإِسْلَامُ كَمَا يَدْرُسُ وَالشُّفَوْبَ حَتَّى لَا يُدْرَى مَا الصَّلَاةِ وَلَا الزَّكَاةِ وَلَا الصَّوْمِ وَلَا النُّسُكِ وَيُسْرَى عَلَى كِتَابِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى فِي لَيْلَةٍ وَاحِدَةٍ حَتَّى لَا يَبْقَى فِي الْأَرْضِ مِنْهَا مِنْهُ آيَةٌ. Islam is going to fade away the same way that the embroidery of your thobe fades away. The brand new thobe, when you have it, it has the ink in it, the dye in it, and it's a strong color. It has the embroidery. You wear it, you wash it, you iron it, you wear it, wash it, iron it, wear it, wash it, iron it. You keep doing that, and the ink gets lighter, and it becomes tattered. He said Islam is going to fade away the same way that that fades away, to the point where the Muslims won't know what is salat, what is zakat, what is sawm, what is hajj. And in one night, the Quran is going to be lifted up from the earth and there won't remain in the earth one ayat of the Quran. One Muslim won't know Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. He won't know that. The Basmala is an ayat of every surah of the Quran with the exception of Surah Tawbah. He won't know Sad is an ayat of the Quran. Yasin, Alif Lam Mim. He won't know Qul Huwallahu Ahad. So if we continue to be on this cultural Islam, the cultural Islam, big masjid, nice masjid, but the religion that we're teaching is cultural. It's not the kitab, it's not the sunnah, the way the companions were upon it, ridwanullahi alayhim, but we're teaching them the Islam that our fathers were on this way. And I'm not against anybody's father here. I'm not against it, I'm just making a point. So Islam will continue to fade away, if the Prophet came back today, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a lot of what the Muslims are claiming Islam, Rasulullah would be free from it. And as a revert to this religion, as a revert, I'm speaking from that prism. A revert comes to the religion and he meets the Arabs from wherever they come from. He meets the Asians wherever they come from. Africans wherever they come from. Muslims. And he says to the people, teach me the religion. He's going to get all kind of stuff. And most of it is what people's parents taught them. It's not what the Prophet brought, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And as I said, if he were to come back right now, he would free himself from most of what we're doing. In an authentic hadith in Sahih Bukhari, Abu Huraira told us, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that Yawmul Qiyamah, a lot of things are going to happen. One of the things that's going to happen is people are going to come to his hold, to his fountain, to drink because they're going to be hot and they need to be, you know, relieved from the difficulty of what's going on Yawmul Qiyamah. So they'll come to his fountain. Anyone who drinks from that fountain, he won't be thirsty again. Anyone who drinks from that fountain, he's going to be soothed on that difficult day. So a group of people from his ummah will come to drink from the fountain and the malaika will get involved. And they say, no, you can't drink from here. You can't come close. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam would get involved to intercede because he loves everybody. Him and his companions, but him particularly. He made a lot of sacrifices for the people sitting here right now today. Personal sacrifices. Allah said it about him in the Quran, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةٍ لِلْعَالَمِينَ لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْكُمْ حَرِيصٌ مَا عَنِنْتُمْ حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ Rasulullah loves our children more than we do. Anyway, he's going to come to try to get people to drink. The malaika are going to say to him, إِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي مَا أَحْدَثُ مِنْ بَعْدِكَ You don't know, Ya Muhammad, what they introduced in your religion after you. Like yesterday, the first of the year. The first of the year, the new year, was created by the Romans in order to worship their god Janus. And they did all of this crazy stuff at the beginning of the year to pay homage and to do ibadah to that god. And the Muslim comes and says, Happy New Year. You ask the average Muslim today, what is today in the Islamic calendar? He doesn't know. Islam is going to fade away, the way the thawb fades away. January, February, March, April, May, June, all of that is kufr and shirk, all of it. Every month is named after a god. Everyone is kufr and shirk. But we know that stuff. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. Kufr and shirk, all of it. Whereas the Islamic calendar, we're going to be asked about that. You're going to be asked about Dhul Qi'dah and Dhul Hijjah and Muharram and Rajab, the sacred months. We're going to be asked about Ramadan. We're going to be asked about these things and that. So Islam is going to fade away. Ask the average person, what's today? Doesn't know. Anyway, the shahid from the kalam, ikhwani, is, those malaika are going to say, you don't know what they introduced in your religion. They did this molid the other day. I don't know if you saw, but on my phone, I have a picture of a big, massive cake. The cake is about 2 stories high. You can't even cut it the right way. And the people were singing, Happy birthday, Ya Rasulullah. Happy birthday. But we'll come to that. The Messenger of Allah, who was sent as a rahmah, he's going to say to the people, suhqan, suhqan, get away, get away. Don't come close to this fountain. Get away, get away. Because you changed your religion. And that's what happened, ikhwani, to these Yahud and these Nasara. They changed their religion. Christmas, Isa never brought them that. Easter, Isa never brought them that. What those people are doing to the Palestinians, Musa never brought them that. They just changed their religion, like the Kufar of Quraysh. Kufar of Quraysh, they used to make tawaf around the Kaaba. Before the Prophet came, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they used to go to Muzdalifah, they used to go to Arafah, they used to go to Mina, they performed Hajj, Kufar of Quraysh. And yet Allah Ta'ala said, وَمَا كَانَ صَلَاتُهُمْ عِنْدَ الْبَيْتِ إِلَّا مُكَاءٍ وَتَصْدِيَا They're praying at the Kaaba. It was nothing but clapping and whistling. They were just partying. That's it. Because what they were calling ibadah, Allah didn't call it ibadah. So now, when we talk about loving the Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the angle that I want to deal with this and address it is an angle that I really want to speak to the younger minds that I hear. Our youngsters, the little ones, and the ones who are really the future of our ummah. Because we, right now, we're looking at a lot of challenges that we're dealing with, like this Islamophobia, like some of the policies that the government is putting into effect to change real Islam, like the challenge of how the media perceives the Muslims. And then we have some young people from our ummah who validate this narrative that Muslims are crazy. So what I want to talk about today is, inshallah, the religious responsibility. If you love the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, everybody here has to defend his religion. Everybody here has to defend him sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But you have to defend his religion and you have to defend him in a way that's correct, not by hook or crook. I wouldn't have ever thought, when I became a Muslim in 1986, I wouldn't have never thought, reading about the personalities of Al-Islam, one of those personalities is Al-Imam Al-Awza'i, who came from Beirut. I always wanted to go to Beirut. I always wanted to go to Syria. I never thought in my wildest dream, Syria would be reduced to rubble the way it is today. Who ever thought that Iraq would become what it is today? Never thought that in my wildest dreams. But that's the reality we're dealing with today. The point that I want to make here is, when it comes to defending the religion, I never thought in my wildest dreams that a Muslim in the streets of London would cut somebody's head off. And don't get it wrong and don't get it twisted. I'm not one of those people that believes everything that the media says. But you also don't be one of those conspiracy theorists that you only believe something if an angel came down and slapped you in your face. I never thought in my wildest dream that a Muslim who's a revert like me, I don't know much about the religion. I'm a brand spanking new Muslim. I'm not a scholar. I need to learn this religion. But I get so worked up and upset, I cut somebody's head off in the street of the capital of London. And I don't run, but I give an interview for the whole world to see. And my interview says, this is what you're going to get if you mess with the Muslims. This is how we are. This is what Muhammad sent us with. And then I'm going to turn around and say, I love the Nabi of Islam, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Again, I repeat and reiterate, don't get it twisted. I'm not one of those people who apologize. I hate two extremes. I hate the extreme of the mutashaddideen, the rough and tough people. And I hate the apologetic Muslims as well. You know, on Sunday morning, that program that comes on Sunday, the big question, I think it's called. They always have those experts who are always apologizing. I hate them guys as well. So-called leaders. They don't represent us. Allah Ta'ala mentioned to those people in the Quran in many, many ayat, not just one. وَلَا تَهِنُوا وَلَا تَهْزَنُوا وَأَنْتُمُ الْأَعْلَوْنَ إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. Don't be weak. Don't apologize. وَأَنْتُمُ الْأَعْلَوْنَ. When you Muslims are upper, you're up, you're above. If you're really believers, don't be apologetic. Don't be like that. The Prophet said about Islam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-Islamu ya'la wa la yu'la alayhi. Islam is uppermost and nothing goes over Islam. So my son, Muawiyah, Usama, Abdullah, all of those guys, I teach them, hey, if anybody asks you who you are to identify yourself, then you have to say, I'm a Muslim who's African-American, who's a muhandis. Don't say you're an American Muslim. Islam is uppermost. So we're living in an environment now where, no, you have to be patriotic. You can't say that. You have to say you're an American first. Where are your loyalties at? No. I'm a Muslim first. Al-Islam ya'la wa la yu'la alayhi. Nothing goes over Islam. So I don't like those guys, but we don't have time to deal with them today. Maybe if we come back again, we'll deal with them. We're going to deal with the mutashaddidun, the rough and tough guys. We don't want our shabab to be like that. No knowledge and rough and tough. So, in loving the Nabi of Islam, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, there's a religious obligation. It's wajib. Not only is it wajib, but it's from the ojib al-wajibat. It's from the most wajib issues that you have to defend him. If you don't feel that way, something's wrong with your religion. You're a fake Muslim. Something's wrong with you. You can't be indifferent. No one is exempt in this masjid. No one. Except if the person is majnoon or the person is dun al balugh. You know, he's a not mature little infant baby who's sitting with his mother right now, sleeping on the floor. La yukallifullahu nafsan illa wus'aha. Those people are not responsible. But everybody else here, you understand what I'm saying? Everybody is responsible for defending him. Defending this religion. But the question is how? There are those people who want to defend al-Islam by hook or crook. They want to defend Islam by a tawheed or shirk. By the sunnah or bidah. By the haqq or batil. By al-adl or al-dhulm. The important thing to him, I just got to do something. Cut someone's head off. I got to blow up the plane. I got to blow up the underground. I just got to do something. I'm going to go over to Syria with 5 children and my wife. I just got to help Islam out. What are you talking about? You have to defend Islam in the correct way, as you're going to see, inshallah. The correct way, not the incorrect way. There's a hadith, guys. Rasulullah said, and this hadith is mutawatir. 17, 18, 19 companions narrated this hadith. And you don't find that. A lot of companions narrating a hadith. It just goes to show the shuhra of the hadith. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, man kathaba alayya muta'ammida fal yatabawa maq'aduhu min an-nar. Anyone who lies on me intentionally, let him prepare his place in the hellfire. So lying on the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a kabira from the kabair. Peddling these weak hadith that we do. Kabira from the kabair. He said, Al-Kathabu alayya laysa ka kathabin ala ahadin. Lying on me is not like lying on anybody else. Why did the religion of the Yahud and the Nasara become the way it is today? Because they lied on their prophets and their messengers. They lied. So the children grow up worshiping a religion that's built on lies. And we have that in our religion. You'll have some masjids where they have books full of lies. The book. Most of it is just lies. And they talk about they're giving the tabligh and a da'wah Allah with a book that most of it is lies. Now this person wants to defend Islam by introducing lies. The hadith said, whoever lies on me, let him prepare his place in the hellfire. This guy, look at his philosophy. He says, after making weak hadith, he said, I didn't lie on Rasulullah. I lied for Rasulullah. I didn't lie on him. I lied for him when I made all this stuff up. About the khatam and the yarmi and the mawlid. And all of this stuff that I made up. These ahadith. Do this, do that, do this. I didn't lie on him. I lied for him. Make the people do good. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Islam is not in need of kithit. Defend him the right way. Defend the religion the right way. Okay. If I'm going to talk about defending the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam the correct way, I just want to share with you guys some examples from what the companions did. And I hope you pay attention to this, really. But before sharing with you the companions, you know the hadith of Jibril, the hadith of Jibril, when Jibril came to the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam and he came as a man, his hair was exceedingly black and his clothes were exceedingly white. He came in the form of a man. And he asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what is Islam? And he told him, he said, what is al-Iman? He said, al-Iman wa tu'mina billahi wa malaikatihi wa kutubihi wa rasulihi. Al-Iman is to believe in the messengers. It is not enough for a person to say, I believe in Allah. I believe in the books. I believe in the angels. I believe in the messengers. Each one of those has a lot of information connected to it. I believe in Allah. I believe where Allah is, where Allah isn't, what He does, what He doesn't do. I believe in His names, His attributes. There's a lot connected to that. It's not enough to say, I believe in Allah, and that's it. I believe in the books. That entails a lot. I believe in the messengers. This is the point. I believe in the messengers. Believing in the messengers, it means a lot. One of the things that we believe about the prophets and the messengers, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhim ajma'in, is that they were the best people, and they were a'imma, and that they were the qudwa, that they should be followed. They should be followed. So look what happened when we talk about defending the Nabi. Hey, are you guys with me? Are you guys with me? We're talking about defending the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the best human beings are the prophets and the messengers. Allah said about all of the prophets and all of the messengers. Allah said about them, وَإِذْ أَخَذَ اللَّهُ مِيثَاقَ النَّبِيِّينَ لَمَا آتَيْتُكُم مِّن كِتَابٍ وَحِكْمَةٍ ثُمَّ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مُصَدِّقٌ لِمَا مَعَكُمْ لَتُؤْمِنُنَّ بِهِ وَلَتَنْصُرُنَّهُ. And remember, when Allah took a contract, Allah took an agreement, Allah took an ahd, aqd, He took an agreement with all of the prophets, and He said to each and every one of them, after I have given you your book, and I gave you your hikmah, your sunnah, and then Rasulullah Muhammad comes to you, you have to believe in him, and you have to help him. So every Nabi and every Rasul that was sent, from the time of Adam to Isa ibn Maryam, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhim ajma'in, every one of them, when they came, they used to tell their people, Muhammad Rasulullah is coming. And if he comes while I'm here, I'm going to take a back seat and we have to follow him. And all of them were waiting for Rasulullah to come. To do what? Once he comes, all of the prophets and the messengers have to believe in him and help him. Not just believe and sit back in the cut and cool out. You have to believe in him. And you have to help him. Idris, Dhul-Kifl, all of them. Yusuf, Yaqub, Ibrahim, all of them. His grandfather, Ibrahim, all of them. If Muhammad comes, I'm going to back up and I'm going to believe in him and I'm going to help him. So if we say we believe in the prophets and they're the best of the people and they're an example, then the first point I want to make known to you is helping the Nabi and defending his religion is not a small thing. It's a serious issue. It's a serious issue. It's not a joke. Because Allah took this covenant out from all of the prophets and messengers. And they're the best of the people. So it gives the one who has an intellect an indication. This is not a joke. This is serious business that we're dealing with right now. This is not about being a nominal, fake Muslim. Nominal. And another thing is, if we choose not to help him, we should know that doesn't hurt Allah one bit. And it really doesn't hurt his religion. It doesn't hurt Allah one bit. Allah said about himself and about the Prophet ﷺ, Wallahu ya'asimuka min al-nas. Allah is going to protect you, ya Muhammad, from these people. Allah told the Prophet ﷺ, Inna kafaynaka al-mustahzi'een. We are enough for you concerning those people who want to ridicule you. They want to do draw Muhammad Day, whatever they want to do. Muhammad, he did pedophile. He was a womanizer. Muhammad was Majnun, no problem. Doing their time and people do it now. Allah is enough for you. He's going to deal with them. So many ayat. There's an ayat that Allah Ta'ala mentioned, إِلَّا تَنْصُرُوهُ فَقَدْ نَصَرُهُ اللَّهُ إِذْ أَخْرَجُهُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا ثَانِيَ اثْنَيْنِ إِذْ هُمَا فِي الْغَارِ. If you people don't want to help him, then you should know. Allah helped him when he was one of two. When they escaped and the kuffar of Mecca pushed them out and he went to the cave and he was one of two. So Rasulullah was in a cave. Who was the other person in the cave with him? Was it Abu Huraira? Anas ibn Malik, Abu Bakr. Now I want to ask you. Rasulullah escaped from Mecca and he went to the cave with Abu Bakr over 1,437 years ago. Was anybody here there at that time? Anybody was here? Nobody was here. Nobody was there. And yet right now there are over 1 billion Muslims. Why? Because Allah helped him when it was just him and Abu Bakr. Allah doesn't need us. Many ayat speak to that point. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu man yartadda minkum an deenihi. فَسَوْفَ يَأْتِ اللَّهُ بِقَوْمٍ يُحِبُّهُمْ وَيُحِبُّونَهُ أَعِزَّةٍ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَذِلَّةٍ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَعِزَّةٍ عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ يُجَاهِدُونَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَلَا يَخَافُونَ لَوْمَةَ لَائِمٍ. Oh, you believe, if any of you leave Islam, you left all of Islam and you apostated, if any of you leaves Islam, Allah will get rid of you and he'll bring another group of people. Allah will love them and they'll love Allah. Allah doesn't need us. That's if you leave the whole religion. Allah just get rid of you and bring some other people. What if the person wants to leave some of the religion? He doesn't want to pray. She doesn't want to wear hijab. Now, if you leave the whole religion, Allah doesn't need you. He's going to bring those people who are going to help his religion. So if you leave some of your religion, then, you know, al-qiyas, min bab al-awla, Allah Azza wa Jalla doesn't need us. So as it relates to defending him, now I really need you guys to pay attention. As a matter of fact, for some, incentive. I'm not a rich guy. I got a lot of kids and stuff like that. But I got £20. I'm going to give this £20 to any one of you, Shabab. Any one of you. At the end of the class, when I ask you 3 questions, if you answer them, I'm going to give you this dough. But you're responsible for everything that I mentioned here today. Every hadith, every name, everything. Think I'm just going to give you £20 just like that and you don't do no work for it? So I want you to pay attention. How did the companions defend the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And my talk is not against the people who acquiesce, the people who apologize, those weak experts of Islam. I saw one of them, he's a graduate. And he's also a professor at Oxford University, prestigious university. He comes on the big question on Sunday morning and he brags. And he says, hey, I've married over 50 Muslim women to non-Muslim men. Islam is forward thinking. The burqa, the niqab is not from Islam. It's from the ways of the Taliban. And it's from the ways that the Arabs oppress the women. These ignorant experts. I'm not talking about those people who acquiesce and placate and apologize. We're talking about the rough and tough guys. People want to do Charlie Hebdo, that type stuff. People want to burn people alive and say this is Islam and the Khilafah. People want to do crazy stuff. When I first came to this country, I saw one of these people was speaking. He was being interviewed by the BBC. They said to this young man, what would you do if you people got the Khilafah? What's the first thing you would do if you got the Khilafah here in the UK? He said, we will chop the heads off of all women who don't wear hijab. But our religion, Rasulullah brought a religion like that. Helping the Nabi. First example. When the first ayat of Islam came down on Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam from Surah Al-Alaq, Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. Jibril came to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam 2 times in his original form. Only 2 times. 600 wings. His wings, they covered and extended to the east and the west. And the Prophet said it was the heaviest way. It was the most difficult way. He went through that for us. Someone comes and says, just a sunnah. Just a sunnah. And then he wants to turn around and says he loves the Nabi. I made Hajj this year. I was with Hajj with a group of people who were saying, just give us the Quran. We don't believe in the Sunnah. Just give us the Quran. We don't believe in the Hadith. And yet the guy was standing in line to kiss the black stone for over 2 hours. When he came back, I said, why were you in the line trying to kiss the black stone? The Quran doesn't mention anything about the black stone. Quran doesn't mention anything about Zamzam water. Quran doesn't mention anything about these details of Hajj. Why are you being philosophical? Give me the Quran and not the Sunnah. Anyway, Jibril came He told him those ayat. Rasulullah went to our mother Khadija, radwanullahi alayha. He told her the story. She supported him. She said, listen, you're a good person. You do this, you do that, you do this, you do that. I have a cousin. His name is Waraqa ibn Nawfal. Let's go to him. He has some knowledge of this stuff because he's a Christian. There's a narration that said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to the edge of the mountain and he wanted to throw himself over the mountain because he thought he was majnoon and possessed. That narration is da'ifa. Rasulullah would never think about killing himself. No prophet, no Rasul, no Nabi would ever think about committing suicide. Because the prophets and the messengers, they were rijal, kamal, you know, they were complete. Anyone who thinks about killing himself, something is wrong. Because for you to be on the top of the earth, and this side of the earth is always better for you than being on the other side. If you're under the earth, your situation is done. You're finished. You have no more chance. You're finished. On this side of the earth, you have the chance to make tawbah. You have the chance to change your situation. You have the chance to travel somewhere. Make a new life, a new path. So the Nabi never thought, I'm going to kill myself. No prophet or messenger would do that. Got to get rid of these weak narrations. Anyway, she took him to her cousin, Waraqa. When Waraqa heard this story, Waraqa said, "Inna hadha namus alladhi kana yati ila Musa." The one that came to you, that's Jibril, and namus. That was Jibril who used to come to Musa. And then he said, this is the point, "Ya laytani kuntu jada'an indama yukhrijuka qawmuka." Oh, I wish I was young. This man was over 80 years old. White, he was old. He said, oh, how I wish I was young. I wish I was young right now. Because your people are going to put you out. They're going to fight you. I wish I was young so that I can help you. Rasulullah said, are they going to fight me? He said, for sure. No man ever came with what you came with, what you're coming with, except that the people opposed him. Illa udu. People took him as an adu. So the point here is, do you guys not see how Waraqa ibn Nawfal was an old man, over 80 years old? And when he had knowledge from the book, Muhammad is coming and he heard about all of this stuff. As soon as he heard the story, he said, I wish I was young, I would have helped you. That's why some of the scholars said that Waraqa ibn Nawfal was the first Muslim before Abu Bakr, before anybody else, because he had knowledge of the scriptures. So the Prophet said in his haq, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "La tasubbu Waraqa ibn Nawfal, fa inni ra'aytu lahu jannatan aw jannatayn." When you hear the name of Waraqa ibn Nawfal, don't curse him, because I saw that Allah gave him one jannah or two jannahs. So ikhwani here, the point here is, do you not see how Waraqa ibn Nawfal, the old man, the old sheikh, who couldn't do anything, all that he can do in wanting to help was make a tamanni. All he can do is hope. So how is it that the sheikh of our community, the one with white hair, من شاب شيبة في الإسلام كانت له نور يوم القيامة إن من إكرام الله تعالى إجلال ذي الشيبة المسلم. So in our community we have elders. They can't do too much. Physically they can't do too much. But they have to help the sunnah. They have to defend the sunnah. How? Do we expect them to come and paint a building and build? We don't expect that. They're weak. But we expect them to be the first ones who support the truth when it comes. We expect those sheikhs of our community, the elders, men and women, to be the ones who give good advice and good counsel to the youngsters, to the administration. We expect those shuyukh and the elders to be the examples for us. Hey, you're closer to death than some of these older, younger people, Allahu Alam. So you hold on to the sunnah and be an example so that the little kids can see the sunnah in you. For an example, making your beard this color or that color, the things that you're doing. But the elder person, he can't sit on the side and say, my days are done, I'm just going to pray in the masjid, that's it. No, he has something to do. Another example. And what are we talking about here? Defending the Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and how the companions did it. Look at what happened in Mecca. In the beginning of Islam, Mecca was a hostile environment. The Prophet was sitting at the Kaaba, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, along with his companions, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Ukasha, Bilal. All of them were sitting at the Kaaba. The Kuffar of Quraysh were over there getting drunk, getting high. One of them said, "Hey, you see that dead camel over there? Go take his intestines and put it on Muhammad's back. We want some entertainment." Like these shows that come on in this country where these people are being entertained at the expense of Islam. So one of their sufaha, he went and he got the intestines and he came and put it all on the Prophet's clothes and his back. Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Ukasha, all of them just sat there. No one did anything. The only person that did something was his daughter, Fatima, Az-Zahra. She came over to the Sunnah, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. She didn't do her clothes like this. With her bare hand, she started cleaning everything off. Cleaned everything off of the Sunnah, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Defended the Sunnah. She didn't stop there. She went to the Kuffar of Quraysh and she gave them da'wah in Allah. And she gave them da'wah in the way that Allah commanded her in the Quran. In the Quran, there is a surah called Al-Furqan. Al-Furqan. It is a surah that was revealed during the Meccan period. Allah Ta'ala said in this surah, وَجَاهِدْهُمْ بِهِ جِهَادًا كَبِيرًا. Make jihad against them in Mecca. Make jihad. There was no jihad. Make jihad against them in Mecca with it, the major jihad. What does it mean? Ya Muhammad, make jihad against these kuffar in Mecca with the Quran. Give them da'wah with the Quran. So look what Fatima did. She went to those kuffar of Quraysh and she used an ayat of the Quran, some kalam that was mentioned about a man who was during the time of Fir'aun. He believed in Musa, but he hid his Islam. He was afraid of Fir'aun, so he concealed his Islam. But one day he couldn't take it anymore. Fir'aun gave Musa a problem, and this man came out. And he said to Fir'aun, and these are the words that Fatima said. She said, like that man said to the Kuffar of Quraysh, أَتَقْتُلُونَ الرَّجُلَ لَنْ يَقُولَ رَبِّي اللَّهِ. Do you fight a man? Do you kill a man simply because he said, "My Lord is Allah"? So the little young girl, she has more fiqh than most of these people living today. The Quran said, make jihad against them with it. With what? With the Quran. So she went and she read the Quran. Do you kill a man and fight a man and do this to him just because he says, "My Lord is Allah"? He didn't do anything to you people. So you see how the little girl had to defend Islam. How does she defend Islam? With her lisan. Now the question is, why did Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, and Ali, and Ukash, and Bilal, and the rest of them, why did they stay sitting there? They stay sitting there because that's what the Prophet taught them. We're in a hostile environment. Our religion is weak. We don't have power. They can shut us down. Relax. Now, some of our Shabab, some of our people, some of them may be in this masjid, Allahu A'lam. They hear this hadith for the first time. He hears this narration for the first time. And he says, "Wallahi, if I was sitting there with those companions, I would have gotten up and punched the guy in the face and knocked him out." You would have done that? Without asking, why do you think Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali and them, why they didn't do that? Why do you think they didn't do that? Why would you want to do what they're not doing? So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud used to tell his students, قِفْ حَيْثُ وَقَفَ الْقَوْمِ فَإِنَّهُمْ وَقَفُوا عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ. Stop where the companions stopped, because they stopped with knowledge. The companions didn't do anything, not out of cowardness and being afraid. But that they understood. If one of them would have gotten up to do something, the Kuffar of Quraysh, they'll kill Rasulullah. They'll kill everybody. Go get your women and your families and your property. And Islam doesn't spread. So stop where the companions stopped. If the companions did the mawlid, then let's do the mawlid. But if the companions didn't do the mawlid, don't do the mawlid. Now, I don't think anyone here would challenge me and say to me when I say, you see, if the companions didn't do anything and they allowed all of that to happen to the Nabi, then we should be like them. I think everybody would agree. Everybody would agree with me. But then when I come and I put this to the community, Did the companions do the molit? No, they stopped. They didn't do that. Molit wasn't introduced until 400 years after the prophet came, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then stop where the companions stopped. Number three, the old man, the sheikh, he has to defend Islam like Waraka. The young girl, your daughter and my daughter, Arwa, 8 years old, 9 years old, Sudaysa, they have to defend the Nabi. The little girls. I'll give you another example. Another example. Our mother Aisha, radiallahu anha, she was sitting with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when some Yahud walked by. And the Yahud, they said, Assamu alayka ya Muhammad. Assamu alayka, yani death unto you, poison unto you. Yuharrifuna al-kalima al-mawadi'ihi. أفتطمعون أن يؤمنوا لكم وقد كان فريق منهم يسمعون كلام الله ثم يحرفونه عن بعد ما أقلوه. That's how they are. So they said after changing the word, السلام عليكم. When you hear it, you think they said السلام عليكم, but they said السلام عليكم. Rasulullah said وعليكم, back to you whatever you said. Aisha heard it. She got upset. She wants to defend the sunnah. She said, وَعَلَيْكُمْ لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ أَبْنَاءَ الْقِرَدَةِ وَالْخِنَازِيرِ. May the curse of Allah be upon you, you descendants of monkeys and pigs. She was upset. Rasulullah said, hey, Aisha, Aisha, hey, relax. Ruwaydin, relax. She said, Ya Rasulullah, didn't you hear what they said? They said death unto you. He said, I heard them. I'm not stupid. I'm aqil. I'm hakim. I know what's going on around me. I'm not like that person who is having ghafla. I'm the Nabi of Allah. I know what's going on. I know what time it is with the games and the tricks that they're playing. I'm sent by Allah. My sunnah is divine protection. I know. But didn't you hear what I said back to them? I said to them, whatever you said to me, back to you. And my dua is accepted and theirs is not. And then he told her, Ya Aisha, ma kana rifi shay'in illa zanahu. Ease, gentleness was never put inside of something except it made it beautiful. It beautified it. And it was never taken out of something except it made it ugly. So when Aisha wanted to defend the sunnah like that, Prophet Muhammad said, no, don't defend Islam by hook or crook. Don't defend Islam in any way. My wife, my sister, your daughters, they want to protest. So they're going to go and march and do a protest, mixing with men. We're going to say, hey, you can't defend Islam like that, sister. My daughter, she wants to call to Islam. So she's going to start doing hip hop music in front of men, doing hip hop with music to make young people be encouraged. Come to Islam. Islam is beautiful. Hey, you can't defend Islam like that. You have to call to Islam and defend Islam in the right way. Not any way, in the right way. Rasulullah didn't allow Aisha to continue. Look at the next example. And there are many. There are two boys. I'm going to ask you this question. One, they were brothers. One, his name was Mu'adh. And the other one, his name is Ma'udh. Mu'adh and Ma'udh. The two sons of Ifra. Both of them were young. They didn't reach the age of puberty. They were young, 13, 12. And the Prophet allowed them to participate in the Battle of Badr. And they were young. So one of them said before the war to Abdurrahman ibn Auf, one of the 10 people promised Jannah, Ya Ammi, hey uncle. He said this so the other one wouldn't hear. Show me where Abu Jahl is. Where's Abu Jahl? He was shocked. He said, Abu Jahl, what do you want with Abu Jahl? He said, I took an oath. I'm going to kill him here today or I'm going to die trying. The young man, he grew up in Medina. He never was in Mecca. He doesn't know Abu Jahl. Abdurrahman ibn Auf, he's from Mecca. He knows Abu Jahl. He said, I took an oath, another. He said, I'll tell you. The other son, the other brother, his brother, didn't want him to hear. Hey, uncle, where is Abu Jahl? Show me. What you want with Abu Jahl? He said, Abu Jahl used to curse the Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'm going to deal with him today. He said, I'll show you. When the war of Badr began, and Ikhwani, Abu Jahl wasn't a joke. Abu Jahl wasn't a chump. He wasn't a punk. Abu Jahl was the type of guy who people were afraid of him in Jahiliyyah. He was a man of respect. I don't know any personality in the dunya, Muslim, kafir, who's like Abu Jahl. So like Obama. Obama is the president of America. He has a lot of power. Obama's not like Abu Jahl because he's cool. He plays around. He jokes. Abu Jahl wasn't a joke. Any Arab would tell you about the history of the Arabs. Abu Jahl wasn't a joke. If you can imagine, and this is a sorry example, but if someone said to one of you guys, okay, you. You got to go and fight Mike Tyson. Most of us going to say, man, I ain't fighting that guy. Most of us going to say, I'm not, because you don't want to get in the ring with a guy like that. Although he's over the hill. Abu Jahl was more serious than that in terms of his personality. And these two kids are saying, where's he at? When the war started, both of them went after Abu Jahl without looking and paying attention to their peripheral vision. Because someone can shoot you with an arrow, someone can stab you, you gotta be safe. They didn't care. They went straight to Abu Jahl. When they got to Abu Jahl, they jumped on him and they killed Abu Jahl. Two young Muslim kids who didn't reach the age of Balugh. They came to the Prophet after the war, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they started arguing with each other. One of them said, I killed him. The other one said, No, I killed him. Rasulullah said, relax. Show me your swords. They pulled their swords out, and both of them had the blood of Abu Jahl on it. Rasulullah said, both of you killed him. Now, our kids in this majlis who are 20, 21, 13, 14, what are they arguing over? They're arguing over whose turn is it with the PlayStation. It's my turn. No, it's his turn. No, it's my turn. And he's arguing with his brother. Whose turn it is? No, it's my turn. No, it's his. Those people during them times, it wasn't like that. They had what is known as Ulul Himmah. They were on another level. Now, the reason why I'm giving you this hadith about these two young men is not to encourage anybody to go out and kill someone. I'm sharing with you an incident to show you that the old man, the sheikh, has to defend the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam like Waraka. The young girl, my daughter, my sister, your sister, has to defend the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The youngsters in our masjid, the young boys, they have to defend the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I'm not telling anybody to go out and kill someone. I'm sharing that hadith to show you the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, without any exception, every tabaqa from the society, everybody felt responsible after defend them. Look at this example. Authentic incident. It's kind of gory, but I'm going to tell you this for the sake of just extracting this lesson from it. There was a blind man. He was a'ma. He couldn't see. He had a slave girl, an amma, a slave girl. Because back then, Islam allowed allowed slavery. But slavery in Islam, it has fiqh connected to it. If you don't know the fiqh of slavery, then the people today can come and say, hey, there's slavery in Islam, and then you start apologizing because you don't know and you don't understand what is the fiqh of slavery. If you knew the fiqh of slavery, you would be able to tell them, hey, I'm not apologetic and I'm not going to be on the defensive. Because that's in your book as well. That's in the Torah and the Injil as well. And slavery in Islam is not what it is with you people. And the United Nations doesn't have any ability, any haq, to make slavery mansukh. But the point is, that man had a slave girl. And she was a non-Muslim. And she used to curse the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the master, the Sayyid, used to tell her, you better stop. But because he loved her, كان يستفيد منها واللبيب بالإشارة يفهم كان يستفيد منها فوائد. He used to get benefit from her, so he allowed her. But he would tell her, you better stop. And one day he couldn't take it anymore. He knocked that lady over on her back. He put his knees on her shoulders. He took an axe and he cracked her head open. And he hit in the stomach, and she had a baby, and he killed the baby. He cracked her head open, hit in the stomach, stomach opened up. She had a baby and he killed the baby. So the news began to spread. Because the companions, they were a group of people who knew if you murder someone, this is a big thing in Islam. Hey guys, in the deen of Allah, to murder someone is a kabira from the kabair. Ijtanibu as-sabal mubiqat. Stay away from seven sins that will destroy you. One of them, he mentioned, قَتْلُ النَّفْسَ الَّتِي, killing someone that Allah didn't allow you to kill. قَتْلُ النَّفْسَ الَّتِي حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ. Don't kill anybody in this religion. That's a big thing to kill somebody in this religion. The Prophet said about murder, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَا يَزَالَ الْمُؤْمِنِ فِي فُسْحَةٍ مِّن دِينِهِ مَا لَمْ يُصَبْ دَمٍ حَرَامٍ. A person will always have the opportunity that Allah will forgive him as long as he doesn't kill someone who shouldn't be killed. Abdullah ibn Abbas used to tell people, if you kill someone who's a believer unjustly, you can't go to Jannah. He used to say that to people. So the news spread. Next day at Fajr time, Prophet Muhammad heard the story. They told him this story. He didn't know about it until they told. So if he was Hazir Nazir, he would have been there and he would have known about it. If he knew the ilm al-ghayb, he would have known about it. But the people came and told him at Fajr time. He said, where's this man at? The man stood up in the back. Blind man at Salatul Fajr. He stood up in the back. Rasulullah said to the people, open up the way. Open up the way. Let him come through. And he started walking through. And that's a proof how the sunnah of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam makes it possible for the du'afa to come to the masjid to have access to knowledge from the women and the children and the handicapped, people with special needs, the Muslims. The sunnah shows us, don't leave your shoes, how we do in every masjid. The shoes are all over the place. So if something happens when we run out, the one who has good health, inshallah, he'll get out. But what about the older person who's going to trip over the shoes? What about the guy who's in the wheelchair? What about the guy who he fractured his hip before? So the sunnah said, make the masjid accessible for the du'afa. Cultural Islam, in the cultural Islam, back in our countries, the woman, she doesn't come to the masjid. So she's left ignorant. So whenever there's a janazah, and the women come to the masjid, they don't know what to do. They don't know they should pray two rak'ahs before they sit down. They don't know what to do because there's no access. Even for the Eid, the culture says, don't come to the Eid. She doesn't even think I'm going to the Eid. It's not for her because the cultural Islam is like that. But the sunnah said, no. Rasulullah had a door in his masjid called Bab al-Nisa, Bab al-Nisa. He said to the people, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, التسبيح للرجال والتصفيق للنساء. If the imam makes a mistake, the men should say, subhanallah. And the women, they should clap, showing that women are in the masjid. There was a lady, her kumi was Umhani. Umhani said, حَفِثْتُ قَاف مِنْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This lady said, I memorized Surah Qaf because the Prophet used to read Surah Qaf for every Friday. She memorized that surah. So anyway, after this story, we're going to pray, inshallah, very quickly, after this hadith, not this story. Rasulullah said to that blind man, why did you do that? He said, Ya Rasulullah, that lady, she has two of my other children, Li Minha Lu'atan. I have two sons that I love, pearls. But she was cursing you and cursing you and cursing you and cursing you. I told her, stop. On this day, I couldn't take it anymore. So I knocked it down and I did what I did. Rasulullah said to the people, Ala tashhadu inna damaha hadurun. Everybody bear witness, her blood was halal. What he did was right. Hey, pay attention to this now. Can the person who wants to go and cut someone's head off in the streets of London use this as a hadith, as a proof, a dalil? There was a companion who was blind, he cut the man's head off, chopped the lady's head off. So if I don't like someone who's talking bad about Islam or the Nabi, I can go do the same thing? No. You have to know the context. What's the context of the hadith? I told you that the man was the Sayyid of the lady. That was his slave girl back there, his property back then. In al-Islam, the hudud, capital punishment, is for the imam, is for the khalifa, is only for the leader of the Muslims. It's not for every Amr, Bakr, and Zaid. You can't do that. You can't do that. I've been to places in Africa. In the marketplace, if someone says you stole something in South Africa, they'll come and put a tire over your head, put kerosene on it, and burn you right there. None of that in Islam, vigilantism. None of that. You can't do any of the hudud. But one person can do the hudud other than the khalifa, other than the imam, other than the Muslim leader. And that is the Sayyid. If his slave stole something, Islam, the Prophet allowed him to do the corporal punishment. If they drank khamr, they made zina, akramakumullah. Islam allowed the Sayyid to make the iqamat al-had. That's from the fiqh of slavery. So the reason why I'm sharing this hadith with you, I'm not telling any of you to go out to crack somebody's head open. I'm telling you about an incident that happened along with his background and his context. But it goes to show, even the handicapped person has to defend Islam. Person can't see, can't hear, in a wheelchair, has one arm, one leg. Even that Muslim has to defend the Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you love Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then you have to defend him. But how? That's the question. We have to defend him in accordance to our ability. You have to defend him in accordance to the context, your environment. We're in the UK right now. We're in France right now. We're in Belgium right now. They can shut Islam down if they want to shut Islam down. So everybody has to take it easy. We defend Islam by writing about Islam, by debating. We defend Islam by having, for an example, in the university, those of you in the university, we come, professors and Muslim students. We say, come, general public. We're going to prove about these shubahat. Was Muhammad a womanizer? Does Islam terrorism and so forth and so on? We defend Islam by writing books. We defend Islam by giving sadaqah to the masjid and taking care of the masjid. The point is, you have to get in your lane and get in where you fit in and defend Islam in a way that you have the ability. And don't do something crazy. So before the adhan, and in concluding, any young person in this masjid who is thinking about going to Syria or Iraq or Turkey or any of that stuff, Allah doesn't want that from you. Allah doesn't want that from you. What Allah wants from you is to get yourself an education and be a person who's helping your mother and your father and your family, helping your community. Get yourself an education, inshallah, so that you will position yourself so that in the future, your future, inshallah, you'll be more effective. Is that me apologizing and being afraid? No, wallahi. That's me telling you, you just can't do anything you want to do. Let's go to Syria and do what? What you going to do in Syria? What are you going to do in Syria? You're more effective and you're present here. Your presence, it means more. And those of you who are rough and tough and excited, you need to relax. Allah said in the Quran, وَلَا تُلْقُوا بِأَيْدِيكُمْ مِنَ التَّهْلُكَ. Don't destroy yourselves with your own hands. وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِكُمْ رَحِيمًا. Don't kill yourselves. Allah was forever merciful to you people. Okay, Ikhwani, we're going to stop, inshallah, after this salah. I'm going to ask you guys these questions. Anybody who get the three questions, inshallah, I'm going to give them these $20, these 20 pounds. But like I said, everything in the dars, you were responsible for it. And we'll give you an opportunity to ask questions first before I ask questions, because it wouldn't be fair, because maybe you have questions. So I'll give you a chance to ask those questions. And then after that, we're going to put this money on the table, inshallah. Hada wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak ala nabiyyina wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.